Good morning. We want to welcome you this morning to the Drainage District Board of Directors meeting for today, November the 15th, 2016. The entire court being present, we have a quorum. Please join us in prayer.
Thank you, Judge. All right, let us pray. Father God, we give you thanks for another beautiful day that you've given us this morning, Lord. Just continue to ask you, Lord, for wisdom and understanding, Lord. Continue to provide that wisdom, understanding, guidance, peace to this elected body that you've appointed, Lord, this judge and four commissioners that lead this great county, Lord. Be with them as they just make these difficult decisions that affect us all, Lord. Continue to provide that same wisdom, understanding to myself, my staff, and the rest of the leaders of this county, Lord, because we know that we want to do our best to serve you and to do the best for this great county that we live in, Lord. I ask this in your son Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Under open forum, we have one presenter, Mr. René Villarreal and Lupita Perez, but they're together, it appears. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Lupita Perez, and I am the post commander for VFW Post 7473 out of Elsa, Texas. And here with me this morning is my senior vice commander, Efrain Solis, his wife, Irma Solis, who is our she's our vice president for the auxiliary, and René Villarreal, which is our public relations for the VFW. And the reason we're here this morning is without the support of our county, of our county leaders, our city leaders, the VFW would not be able to do what they do. We're veterans helping veterans out, and without you, we would not be able to do what we do. So I want to thank you. In the city of Elsa, if a veteran needs help, the city does not have to worry about what to do with that veteran because the VFW takes care of them. The same thing happens with the county. If the county has a veteran in need in that area, all they do is call the VFW, and we take care of them. Veterans helping veterans. But with that said, it would not be possible with the great support that an individual has given us throughout the years. The 3 years I've been a commander, we've had tremendous support from this individual. So this morning we're here to present a plaque to an individual who has been instrumental in our success of being an All-American, an All-State post, and we're ranked number 4 in the world with everything we do. So our little town of Elsa, Texas, reached those goals because of this individual.
Get close to the microphone. I took the post of a public relations officer a year and a half ago, and throughout my time, I've known this individual, and to be precise, not a lot of people know who I was. But as time went on, this individual started calling me by my name, and I was surprised because not a lot of people know who I am. But I am very grateful for his friendship and for the leadership skills he has shown throughout this time that he has helped us at this post. And I know his family, and his uncle was the one that brought me into this world. And I am very grateful for knowing this individual, and he is a great asset to our post. And I just want to say thank you very much.
Good morning. Thank you all for having us, Judge, Commission. We are truly grateful to be able to be here and present a deserving individual with what is a small token of our appreciation for the help that he has rendered above and beyond anybody that could have been there probably. And we sincerely believe that he has helped us since the day he came in the picture in Precinct 1. And I think by now you know who we're talking about. And the entire post, the entire membership, wish they could be here, but it would be too many people to crowd in here. But we are all appreciative of what he has done for us, and this is how we want to thank him. It's only a part of what we do in return for all that he has done for us. Again, thank you so much. Thank you for having us, and we're here to serve you anytime you need us.
Mr. A.C. Cuellar Jr., in appreciation of your contribution to our post, thank you for continued support to the fellow, your fellow veterans, and to the veterans that work hard to get it done. Since 2012, Commander Lupita M. Perez, 2014-26 through 2016, this November 15th of 2016. Mr. A.C. Cuellar, if you could come up front for us to please present you with this award. Thank you so much.
Item, our approval of our consent agenda. Any concerns?
No, sir. None that I'm aware of. I think it is in order, sir.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you. If I may, sir, item five, discussion about county drainage issue number one, drainage projects maintenance and operation. We're, I guess, moving forward. We do have a meeting in precinct two tomorrow with, I believe, about 30. Approximately about 30 individuals, Lupe will be meeting with, and some other community leaders to discuss some of the projects that we're doing in Precinct 2, some of the projects that we've completed in Precinct 2 regarding drainage, and some of the proposed projects that are ongoing right now. Just continuing our transparency and presenting as much information as we can out there to the public. We're working on the development of our website. We do have a third-party website provider already. On board and getting that set up, so we hope to get a lot more information out. And our staff is going through right now, currently a PRIDE training, which stands for Promoting Responsibility, Integrity, Dedication, and Ethics. It's a one-hour class that all our staff is taking, and leaves about a half hour for questions and answers. That presents real case scenarios on issues. Whether it be administrative or maintenance and operation regarding county district property and so forth. So things, you know, that could come up. This is a yearly thing that we're going to start doing to better educate our employees and train them so they can be better equipped to make better decisions. So I just wanted to brief the board on that. That's all I have today.
All right, sir, go ahead.
Thank
six.
You. Presentation, acceptance, and independent audit report from the year ending December 31st, 2015. We have our auditors here to make the presentation.
There he's got one. There we go.
Judge, Commissioners, good morning. My name's Ricky Longoria. I'm a partner with Bird. Good morning, Judge. My name's Ricky Longoria. I'm a partner with Burton McCormick Cortez. Our firm was engaged to complete the audit of the Drainage District for the year ended December 31st, 2015. Today I have here with me is Adele Felix. So you may remember Adele from last year. She was the on-site CPA manager who actually conducted the audit. She was the individual who worked directly with the staff and the team at the Drainage District to get the audit done. Again, this is a financial statement audit, the purpose of which is to opine on the fairness of presentations of financial statements, and Adele will definitely go through that with you. A couple of things. I do see Ms. Lotus in the audience, and I think she would not be happy if I didn't recognize the fact that Adele was actually a Head Start graduate. And so I'm glad I covered that base for the Head Start team. And she's also from at Calchelsa, and she's done a great job for our firm. I also want to touch real quickly on what Raul mentioned and on the training. That training is actually being facilitated by our firm. It was a training that we developed about 10 years ago, and we've seen a lot of our clients engage us to perform that training, including some public entities such as STC. Again, the purpose of the training is just to pull folks aside and groups of folks aside and get them to focus on really the bigger pictures to what a public entity means to a community and to a region. And so when Raul mentioned, you know, giving examples, we give examples of maybe things to consider as to whether they're right things to do or not right things to do. And so it's really an engaging type of training, and certainly it's a training that we would offer to any department throughout the county as a whole. We found it to be very effective because it does certainly start a conversation about the importance of a public entity and its role, again, within the community. So I want to thank Raul and his team for seeing the bigger picture and knowing the importance of what it takes to be a public entity. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Adele, who will go over the audit report with you all.
Hi, good morning, Judge, Commissioners. Again, I'm Adele Felix. I'm an audit manager who was in charge and oversaw the Drainage District audit for 2015. I'm here to present those statements. Now, in front of you, you should have three documents. You should have the bound green report and two letters. One, which I believe is about three pages, is our comments and recommendations that we've discussed with management, and also includes their response as well as a corrective action plan for the year. And the next letter is it's our governance letter, which I'll start with that one. It's a two-page letter. This is required communication that we must have with the governing body of the district. I'm just going to highlight a few items. Professional standards require that we provide you with information about our responsibilities under generally accepted auditing standards and government auditing standards. And the significant accounting policies used by the district are described in Note A, and a highly encourage you to read through those just to kind of get a better understanding of the statements. And you should be aware that accounting estimates were used in preparing these financial statements, and those estimates are based on management's knowledge and experience about past and current events. Some of those estimates include allowance for uncollectible taxes and the net pension liability. Now, the net pension liability is a new disclosure that GASB 68 now requires us to put it on the face of the financials. It was disclosed in previous years, but just included in the notes. So that's just something new you'll see on the financial statements, as well as the useful life of fixed assets and related depreciation. Okay, the next item, difficulties encountered in performing the audit. Fieldwork did begin a little later than originally scheduled. We've already met with management and set up a plan for next year to kind of coordinate the completing the audit on a timelier basis. Next page. Corrected and uncorrected misstatements. All adjustments have been posted and are reflected within the financial statements. Any disagreements with management? We do have discussions throughout the audit, but nothing to the level of a disagreement. And to confirm to you that we did receive a signed management representation letter dated October 21st. The last item is management consulting with other independent accountants. This could be viewed as opinion shopping. You don't like what we said, you get somebody else to tell you what you need. That, to our knowledge, that did not happen, or was it necessary? So that's all I have for this letter. Unless you have questions, I'll move on to the report. Okay. If you turn to page 11. This is our independent auditor's report. This describes our responsibility as auditors as well as management's responsibilities with respect to the financial statements. Management is responsible for the preparation and fair presentation of these statements, which includes the design, implementation, and maintenance of internal controls. Our responsibility is to express an opinion on these statements based on our audit and to confirm to you that we did perform our audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards as well as government auditing standards. On the next page is our opinion, the very top. In our opinion, the statements are presented fairly in all material respects. The respective financial position of the district as of December 31st, 2015. Now, this is an unmodified opinion, which is interpreted as a clean opinion. And that's the highest level of assurance that an audit can receive. Okay. You turn to page 23. I'm just going to go over a few numbers. Page 23 is a statement of net position as of December 31st, 2015. This is what we call the snapshot of the district at that point. We have total assets of $243 million, and that most of that is capital assets, which is $133, which increased about $11 million, and that's due to infrastructure, of course. And this year, I did have the opportunity to go out to some of the construction sites, so it was nice to put the testing to actual sites. And I know that that's with the efforts of trying to update the website, the newsletter, which will show the projects as well as the cost to date, which, you know, we commend the district for trying to be more transparent, their efforts to be transparent with the public. Total liabilities totaled $163 million, and most of that has to do with bonds, which was $156 million. Which is a decrease of $8 million due to some refunding bonds that were done throughout 2015. And if you turn to page 25, last page, I promise. Under the general fund column, under unassigned, we have fund balance of $21.8 million, which exceeds the internal goal of 10%. There was an increase of $5 million, and that's for two reasons. One is they did receive a grant of about $6 million last year that will not be received in 2016. So that's something to consider. And there was an increase in expenditures due to more in-house projects the drainage is performing. So this fund balance is important in case of a natural disaster or, of course, like the in-house projects that they're doing now. Now, what I went over is just very broad. There are additional details to those statements in the notes to the financial statements, which I highly encourage you to go through. There is no single audit for 2015. They did receive a grant, but they didn't meet the single audit requirements for that, so that wasn't performed. But other than that, that's all I have, unless you have any questions.
How did you treat or pick up the money that we're still owed by DHS, the $2.5 or $2.9 million related to the construction of that border wall and fence?
Well, that is not actually recorded in the financial statements because at this point it hasn't been determined collectible. Once that money is determined to be collectible, it will be recognized within the statements.
Are there any questions? Go ahead.
Judge, just a comment. Along with this report, as well as the county report that we're going to address later, certainly we've always made ourselves available to each and every one of you all to sit down and go over the financial statements. I certainly appreciate that it's very difficult under 5 minutes to try to encompass the whole audit aspect of our work. But certainly I just want to continue to let you know that certainly we are here to serve you. Provide you the information that you need in order to make the decisions that you all need to make. And so certainly as our office continues to reach out to each of you all's offices, certainly feel free to reach out to us. And certainly we'll gladly spend the time and walk over in more detail or go over whatever questions and concerns you all may have. So certainly please know that's always open to each and every one of you.
Thank you.
Judge, you need a motion of acceptance. Mm-hmm. So move.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If I may, sir, item 7. Item 7A, requesting approval of final negotiated agreement for professional serving services with the New Haley Associates, Inc., as it relates to services for on-call, on-as-needed basis to Dow County Drainage District No. 1 projects. Approved for negotiations by the ACDD 1 Board of Directors on October 25, 2016, AI 57010, contract number CHDD 116056A1115.
Move for approval. Those in favor, say
aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
7B, requesting approval of fund negotiated agreement for professional serving services with Civil Design Services, Inc., DBA, CDS, Murray, as it relates to services for on-call, on-as-needed basis to Dow County Drainage No. 1 projects. Approved for negotiations by the Board of Directors on October 25, 2016, contract number CDD 116056B-1115.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you. Item 8, request approval of budget amendment from the district's general fund into the heavy equipment in the amount of $402,346.27 for the purchase of a Doosan DX-490 LC excavator. The purchase is for the replacement of one of the district's excavator, which is claimed to Texas Municipal League and has been partially reimbursed. We received $188,000 for that machine, so we're replacing it.
That's the one that got burned, right?
That is correct.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Item 9, requesting approval of drainage easement acquisition from Edinburgh Consolidated Independent School District, being a 2.54-acre tract of land out of Lot 2, R.B. Curry, Survey Number 3, Dow County. It's already been approved by the school board and before the board now for approval.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you. Item 10, request approval to create one right-of-way utility coordinator position for the maintenance operation budget and set salary of $45,923.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Item B, approval of revised salary schedule and budget amendment to fund new position as noted in item A in the amount of $9,500 to fund through the remainder of 2016.
Move for approval.
Second. Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Item 11, request approval of payment of claim in the amount of $1,397.50 to Terracon Consultants, Inc. for the concrete material testing for mile 17.5 and Ware Road project.
Move for approval.
Second. Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 12, requesting approval of closing documents that relate to Precinct 2 Fee Simple Right-of-Way Project Parcel 14.
Move for approval.
Second. Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you. Item 13, authority to publish. Oh, well. On this one, I guess there'll be no item at this time until we discuss it in executive session. I apologize.
Well, we're going to come back when and act on that item, but initially in the discussion, because it relates to certain exceptions under the Texas Government Code, we're going to take the initial discussion will be an executive, and then we'll come back out.
That's correct, Judge. Thank you. We do have the closed session items ready.
All right. Pursuant of Section 551, 071, and 072 of the Texas Government Code, need a motion to proceed to executive session.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. We'll be in executive session. All right. Thank you. We are now back in open session.
Yes, sir. On the real estate acquisition, we'll proceed as directed. Let me see that. That would be... Yeah, an open session, real estate acquisition will proceed as directed. Item 15A, 15B, no action. And 15C will also proceed as directed on that, Judge.
Yes, we're not going to go back to item number 13. We're just going to go ahead and move it on to next week's agenda.
That is correct, Judge. We'll bring it back next week.
I need a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries. Thank you, Rowan.
Thank you.
At this time, we're going to be convening our regular meeting of the Hidalgo County Commissioners Court. The entire court being present, we have a quorum. Please join us in our Pledge of Allegiance.
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being able to live in a nation where we can not all agree, but still get along. And that's a blessing, dear Lord, and we thank you for that. We also thank you for the different seasons that we have, even though everybody says we don't have them in the valley, but we do. And we thank you for cooler weather and rain and all those blessings that you give us that we take for granted. We ask you to bless our nation, bless our families, and help all of us that are here together to work together to get something good done for Hidalgo County. Amen.
Amen. Please remain standing and join us for a moment of silence. I've just been advised that a former county commissioner from Precinct 4, Mr. Leonard Camarillo, passed away this morning. He served us as a county commissioner between 1983 and 1994. Thank you. Our consent agenda, any concerns?
Marty. Motion approved. Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Judge, commissioners, with your permission, I'd like to take item 6 out of order. I do have a tourist board meeting that I must attend. And so item 6 is the executive office. For the sake of expediency, there's nothing to update. 6A, 1 and 2, item, and I'm going to go through the ones that I can fairly quick. Item 6D, there's a request by CrossFit Grandy Valley, along with other local gyms, to use the county square for the following event: Raise Toys for Children community event, November 19th, 2016, from 9 to 12 p.m. Everything's in order. We'll secure all the appropriate entrances.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 9E. I'm sorry. 6E. Requesting approval of the affiliation agreement between for internship, preceptorship program between Hidalgo County and South Texas Independent School District Business Education Technology Academy, also known as BETA.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Judge, commissioners,
I'm sorry. Valde, we have representatives from BETA and two students that they'd like to come up and
sure.
say a few
Go
words.
Ahead. Yes. My apologies.
Sorry.
My apologies. I didn't see you in the audience.
They just arrived.
All blue. Okay.
Good morning.
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 I'm so very proud to be here for the sixth year. Actually, it's five. My name is Nashla Showery, and I am the coordinator, business internship coordinator. And I want to thank you so much for allowing this to happen for our students. It's a great opportunity, and they're very, very happy to be here. One student will be placed at the county clerk's office. The second will be placed, Saul will be placed with the Hidalgo County Community Service Center. And I'm very honored to introduce you to our principal, Dr. Nora Casares, from South Texas Independent School District, Business Education Technology Academy.
Again, I just want to express our gratitude. This is an awesome opportunity for our kids. They look forward to it every year, and we hope to continue placing more and more of them as the years go by. Again, our sincerest thanks.
Judge, commissioners, I'd also like to echo that. It's been a real pleasure having these students in our office. They've been very mature and responsible, and that brings me great optimism that this is our future. So I'm just glad to be a part of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wahart.
Excuse me, it's quick to time.
Yes, sir. There's two more items. Let me go to item 6B, discussion regarding 2017 voluntary party deductions. Judge, Commissioners, there's been a lot of discussion as of late with respect to the proposed deductions under our voluntary products. Just in a nutshell, this is a reconciliation issued with respect to services, a service provided for the purchase of a product after the fact. And individuals that either have left or have moved on to another part of the county that's not affiliated with the county, and the collection of that fee. This is the same issue we had in the past with our health insurance that was rectified by paying the health insurance 1 month in advance. I do understand the concern as of late because the holidays are approaching us. So with that being said, Sergio, unless I've missed something with respect to my Cliff's Notes version of the issue.
No, it really does boil down to just trying to reduce the county's liability, right, in regards to the payment of these premiums. Again, it does cause some issues when we have individuals that leave at the end of the month and we don't receive change of status. We receive notice that they've separated from the county till the month afterwards. Or even individuals that are out and leave without pay. That in the middle of the month they decide they can't afford it. However, that premium is still due for that month. It raises a lot of issues there. It also has issues with payment of people that just enroll in the insurance. Since we do collect that month, again, it still takes 3 to 4 weeks before the payment even goes out after the payments are collected. So it does cause sometimes confusion with the carriers. They do sometimes drop employees because of that non-payment, so we have to go back and cause a lot of administrative concerns from our end, as well as the treasurer's office, and then of course the auditor that has to reconcile and audit all of that. And that's the reason why we decided to recommend to do this in December, because right now December they do have the option to either enroll in the product or not take the product. Again, these are all voluntary products. These are not anything that the employees need to take. So it's the best time that they have to say, yes, we can afford to do this, or no, we can't afford to take this product, which is one of the reasons why we're requesting to have this double deduction in December and try to correct it, similar to what we corrected probably a decade ago with the health insurance premiums.
All right. And again, as I mentioned a little earlier, with the holidays fast approaching, Judge, Commissioners, this is something that we do need to do in order to lessen the liability of the county and for us to lessen the administrative burden, since we do have the fiduciary responsibility with respect to the collection or the deduction of these fees. As a compromise, if the court so chooses, our proposal was to do the double deduction in December.
But yes, that's our recommendation to make that double deduction in December.
As a compromise, if the court would see fit or feels that this would be proper, then I would propose that effective starting in January that we do over the course of three pay periods, a third, a third, and a third.
That's my motion, Valdez.
Okay.
Judge, Commissioner, if we could, another option that we would have as well is in March, we do have the three pay periods in March. So we could have that double deduction be done on the third pay period where there are no other insurance deductions as well. It would create less administrative burden having to do changes.
Plus they get their refunds in February.
That's correct. Yeah. But, I mean, if the court does would prefer not to have these double deductions in December, then if we could have maybe another week so we can work with the treasurer's office, make sure that it's not going to be more work administratively for them and for us, for our office as well, as far as doing it every three months, January, February, and March, as opposed to doing it just one time during the third pay period of March.
And
we
could
just bring that back.
Valdez is suggesting
to do
one
it
third in January, third. February, and March, and you're proposing what?
As a compromise as well, just do it all on the third pay period of March, because March does have three pay periods. We only take deductions on the first and second pay period of every month.
You're going to take the whole month in 2 weeks, right?
Yeah, but it's hurt March, so.
We'll just do it the way we said it.
Third, a third, and a third.
Third and third and third?
Yeah.
If that's what the court desires, we'll get that done.
Those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you, Judge Commissioner.
Thank you, sir.
Judge Commissioners, the final action or the final discussion action item under six is the presentation of Burton McCumber Cortez LLP and the county's 2015 comprehensive annual financial report and single audit. Mr. Salinas in the audience. Judge, Mr. Longoria, I'm sorry. Mr. Longoria, Rick Longoria. Judge Commissioners, with your permission, I do need to be excused for the TERS board meeting I have to attend.
Yes, sir. Go ahead, brother.
May I be excused?
Please.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, Judge. Again, just for the record, Ricky Longoria, partner with Burton McCumber Cortez, again here with Adele Felix. Adele, we'll be going over the financial statement report. As I mentioned earlier, this particular report, I think, is three times larger than the one that we discussed earlier. It's over 300 pages. And so as she goes through there and just speaks to the highlights of the actual report, specifically addressing fund balance, because certainly that's a very critical point of reference or data point with respect to the financial condition of the county. Again, just continuing offering our time to visit with you all individually if you so chose after this meeting. Okay.
Good morning. Again, this might sound very familiar. I apologize, but we got to go through it, right? Okay. Again, I am Adele Felix. I'm the manager with Burton McCumber and Cortez, and I oversaw the county audit for 2015, and I'm here to present those statements. The audited financial statements include the primary government, drainage district, as well as the related agencies, Head Start, Urban County, and Community Service Agency. Now, in front of you have, of course, four documents this time. We have the CAFR, which is a large report, the single audit report, which is a green-bound copy, and then two letters. One, again, is our comments that did not make the single audit report, but we just felt should be brought to your attention. It includes management's responses and corrective action plan for the coming year. Also, we have the required communication, which I apologize, I will go over again. The significant accounting policies are included in the county's note one to the financial statements. You should be aware that there are estimates used in preparing these financial statements and that those estimates are based on management's knowledge and experience about past and current events. Those estimates include allowance for uncollectible taxes, and like I mentioned before, the net pension liability, which is now disclosed in the face versus the notes in previous years. Also, the useful lives of fixed assets and depreciation. Difficulties encountered in performing the audit. We did have numerous adjustments that were provided by management after the original trial balance. It was an improvement from last year, and I know that we're working with the county to kind of minimize this number of adjustments provided afterwards. Corrected and uncorrected misstatements. Just to confirm to you that all adjustments have been posted and are reflected within the financial statements. Disagreements with management. There are discussions throughout the audit process, however, they're nothing to the level of a disagreement. Confirm to you that we did receive a signed management representation letter dated July 22, 2016, and management consulting with other accountants. Again, this could be viewed as opinion shopping. To our knowledge, that did not happen, or again, wasn't necessary. I'll move on to the CAFR. You go to page 13. This is our independent auditor's report. This describes our responsibility as auditors as well as management's responsibility with respect to the financial statements. Management is responsible for the fair presentation and preparation of these statements, which includes the design, implementation, and maintenance of internal controls related to the preparation of the statements. And our responsibility is to express an opinion on these statements based on our audit. And to confirm to you that we did perform our audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards, government auditing standards, and uniform guidance. At the bottom of that page is our opinion. In our opinion, the statement, financial statements are presented fairly in all material respects. The respective financial position of the county as of December 31st, 2015. Now, this is an unmodified opinion, which is interpreted as a clean opinion, which is the highest level of assurance that an audit can receive. You go to page 26 and 27. The statement of net position, which is a snapshot of the county as of December 31st, we have total assets of $983 million, which is an increase of $68 million from prior year. And like I mentioned, the new disclosure, our pension liability needs to be disclosed here. Well, we have, I'm sorry, the deferred outflows for pension, it was included in the notes in previous year, but this includes the contributions that were made subsequent to the valuation date, as well as investment earnings that will be recognized over time, which is why it's deferred. And then on page 27, we have $608 million of liabilities, and the majority of that is the total debt, which is $173 million for the primary and $156 million for the drainage district, which is about half. And the net pension, like I mentioned, this is a liability that was determined by a third-party actuary, and it's to be paid out throughout future dates as necessary, which is a new requirement. Now, page 31. Under the general fund column, unassigned fund balance, we have an unassigned fund balance of $26 million at year-end. This is an increase of $6.7 million, which is an increase of 34% from previous years. And per internal policy, an acceptable level is 10%. At December 31st, it was at 15.4%. So what does that mean? It means that worst case scenario, if there was no money coming in, you could basically function for 56 days. And there's two reasons for that. We did have an increase in revenue, and it's not based on tax rate increases, but more on valuation. And also, there was a decrease of expenditures of about $2 million. So the county's conservative efforts are being shown within the fund balance this year. So, again, that's a broad, you know, I just kind of highlighted a few items. The notes to them will include details. There was a big change in disclosures related to the pension, so I encourage you to read through those. But I'll move on to the single audit unless there's any questions about the statements.
Are there any areas of concern we need to look at, any issues you may have discovered or uncovered?
Do have comments included in our single audit report. This is where our significant deficiencies are disclosed, and it includes our management responses and the plan for next year. Now, there is one that we always bring up is the clearing of repeat comments, and that is included in the single audit report. So, do you want me to briefly describe the single audit? Because the county receives over $92 million of federal and state grants, a single audit is required, which includes additional testing for compliance under those grants, as well as internal control over those compliance issues. But again, our comments are included in here. And then that separate letter includes our other comments that didn't make it to the report.
All right.
Okay?
Thank you.
Okay, if you'd like to meet with us and discuss any issues, we'd gladly make ourselves available.
Thank you.
Judge,
no motion.
Second.
Judge, I'm sorry. I just have one comment and more for the public consumption. The audit report for the County of Hidalgo has earned the GFOA award for the past 10 plus years, right here. But it's multiple years, and it's really a recognition of the comprehensive annual report from a third party, also saying that the audit report is clear and concise, and although I realize it's 300-plus pages long, easily readable by, I guess, an accountant's definition, but certainly we believe that when the county submits, and I think they have already submitted this audit report for evaluation to determine whether they'll get the GFOA award, I'm fairly confident that they will, and so I want to congratulate the county on its continued work to continue to produce a comprehensive annual report that continues to win this award. Again, just highlighting one more thing that Adele mentioned, going through those comments, getting them cleared, so we're not talking about them again next year, I think is very important. Sometimes we'll get comments that tend to drag on for more than a year, and so certainly want to get those addressed, and again, continue to focus, understand from a governance perspective the importance of fund balance. I know you all live and die by fund balance, and so congratulations on increasing that fund balance and a reflection of you all's hard work and making some tough decisions along the way. And so I know you all going through a budget period right now, and certainly continue to focus on fund balance and maintaining it. Thank you, Judge.
Thank you. Do you need an acceptance of it?
Yes, sir.
We've had a motion made and a second. Those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, I'd like to take an item out of order. Item number 5 under the County Judge's Office B, presentation by Mr. Tim, and I apologize if I mispronounce it, Osley, and Mr. Charlie Myers, I would imagine, and possible action regarding the Palm Valley Animal Center.
Thank you, Judge. Commissioners, on behalf of Palm Valley Animal Center and our board of directors, one of which is Charlie Meyer, our board president, Carlos Isaguete, and several board members, we want to say thank you for allowing us the opportunity to share with the court the needs of Palm Valley Animal Center as of today. As most know, the funding for Palm Valley Animal Center over the history of the organization has been done basically in two ways. One, through county and municipal contracts, and secondarily through fundraising, galas, just donations from community leaders and individuals as well as companies. With the advancement of the care that's been provided by Palm Valley Animal Center over the last several years and improvements in the animal welfare, the costs, of course, have been increasing. As you know, I'm sure we have recently opened a new adoption and education center out on 281 here in Edinburgh for the focus of the public image and a place where people can come to adopt, to be educated on humane care of animals. As a result of all of those factors, plus growing our organization in regards to staffing programs, our funding is woefully inadequate across the board. We were funded $1.7 million last year from the municipal contracts, including the counties. Our expenditures exceeded those funds substantially. I have before you several different documents, one of which is a proposed increase in funding from the county as well as the municipalities. The challenge is if the county would agree to the increased funding, which is across the board equal to all municipalities, in and of itself, the county funding would not keep Palm Valley Animal Center open. We are running substantial deficits as it is, and we need to move from about a $1.7 million a year revenue source to about $2.5 million a year. It's an increase of about $800,000. Our request specifically to the county is an increase and modification of an existing contract beginning on January the 1st of $241,000 increase, but it is only substantial or important if we are able to get the rest of the cities to come on board with the increases, equal proportional increases across the board. Otherwise, the only option that the Board of Directors and I will have in regards to Palm Valley Animal Center is to close it and turn that over to the county or the cities for its operation.
Just as a point of reference, the municipal shelter in El Paso has an annual operations budget of right at $5 million a year. They take in less animals than we do at Palm Valley Animal Center. We are operating here at a budget of 2.5. They're shooting for a budget of 6.2 million within 2 years with a 30,000 intake. We know that Palm Valley Animal Center, as a private not-for-profit, can operate it both successfully and less expensively than just about anyone can. So we're coming to you first as kind of our one of our biggest players in funding to request this preliminary funding, but also your support either in bringing on the cities in their support or even the county making a decision saying we're ready to start funding PVAC totally as the county at $2.5 million a year. We'll collect our money from the cities, however you choose to approach it. But in either case, the best option, we believe, as we lead the Palm Valley Animal Center, is for it to stay under the direction of the Board of Directors, keeping our costs low, but getting us to the place where we're actually able to fund it solely from municipal revenue. I want to give you some time for some questions. If you have anything, I'd be happy
How much money are we presently providing the center?
The county, for the contract of that we're in right now for 2017, is $548,000 and a little bit more. And we're requesting an increase of $241,000, bringing it to $790,000 in 2017.
Judge, if I may, I think the board has done an impeccable job. They have a really beautiful facility, and I don't think that I wouldn't suggest that county take over. I think that we have a great partnership in the group and the board, and they're providing excellent service right now. It's just you're obviously operating in a very critical state right now. And the last thing we need to do is we can't just sit back and allow you all to turn it over. We're hoping that you guys can maintain the service. The quality of the service is impeccable. I guess that's the biggest fear that I have. But I'd propose the court to consider the petition of the increase of the $241,000 in hopes that we can also inspire the other cities to do the same. To hopefully make them.
That's
more.
A motion. I'll second it. Yeah. Is that a motion, Justin?
Yes. That's my motion.
How many cities presently have their own center where they have euthanized these animals?
City of Mission, City of Far, Edinburgh has a holding facility, City of Weslaco. Those are the primary ones. Some of them euthanize, some of them don't. We contract with those cities, but with very limited intake from them. The City of Mission, I believe, is supposed to have an adoption program, but I've not heard much of it.
Well, we have a motion and a second. Those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. What is it that we can do now to help you collect from all your other partners?
You guys give them the money and then collect for them.
Yeah, well, that would be wonderful. We'd be happy for that. But really the pressure now is to get all of the rest of the cities within the county to get on board with the funding that's needed. The largest funder of PVAC is the City of McAllen. The proposed, as you have before you, McAllen funding would be an increase of $268,000, bringing them to $877,000 a year, which is the largest funder because they are the largest provider of animals to Palm Valley Animal Center. Makes sense for them to be the largest funder. We could do without a couple of cities getting on board, but we can't do without PSJA and McAllen. If they don't come on board, we don't have an option.
Judge, maybe an idea is to offer a resolution of support, obviously indicating our increase and our commitment to Palm Valley. Start with that. It'd be difficult right out of the bag to fund the entire amount, but let's start there and then revisit how successful we are weeks down the road and see if we can get them all to buy into it as well.
Well, at some point, we need to have a conversation with some of these cities on other things, also like the MOU on the medical school. So might as well have one conversation on this and on that, because we do, you know, we back the cities with TERS and other agreements, so might as well sit down and hash all this out at one time. But hopefully with our support, the other cities will see that we're stepping up to the plate and they can step up to the plate too.
I can now go to the cities and say that county is in support of these increases and is behind us 100%.
Well, it's pretty basic. You need it to be able to operate in the black.
That's correct. That's exactly right.
But the great thing about a nonprofit, it brings two things to the table. It runs efficiently. It runs more less expensively as a municipality, and also has the fundraising aspect to it that a municipality doesn't have, or really doesn't do very well. So we need to support our nonprofits. I think Eddie Olivares wants to make a comment.
Yeah.
With your permission, Judge, I am so excited to hear the proactive approach from Commissioner's Court. Animal control issues in our county, sir, are frankly out of control. I mean, I hate to say that. We have a very limited manpower for that. Our county really needs to look. What I would encourage, just to give you an example, the city of Brownsville's budget alone is $5.6 million. Okay? That is huge. And with the service and the work that these wonderful people do is tremendous. They're very well organized. They have it all set up well. The other part, sir, is I would encourage highly that we work with them on developing a very strong public media campaign, including Ms. Sullivan, on spading and neutering, on the importance of the leash laws. And we encourage that we will support in any form or fashion that we can just public education awareness, because our residents, sir, I'm embarrassed to say this, are not very responsible with their pets.
Well, thank we you. Have CRCs that we can reach out to our community and let them know about that.
Thank you. Other questions?
Gentlemen.
Thank you all for being here and being patient.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for what you do. Thank you. All right, moving back on to item number 5A.
Good morning, Commissioners, Judge Julia Benita Sullivan with Public Affairs. Item 5A is a proclamation declaring November 2016 is National Home Care and Hospice Month to recognize the services provided and the nurses, home care aides, therapists, and social workers who help care for those in need. And we have a representative here with us, registered nurse Nancy Perez. You can go ahead and join us, Nancy. The proclamation reads, whereas during the month of November, the home care and hospice community honor the millions of nurses, home care aides, therapists, and social workers who make remarkable differences for the patients and families that they serve. And whereas Home Care Aid Week takes place this week, November 13th through the 19th, the aides work with nurses, therapists, and social workers to provide high-quality and compassionate health care services to those in need, especially at times of community or personal health care crisis. And whereas home care in Texas is a growing alternative to hospitalization or other institution-based forms of health care for acute and chronic illnesses, providing care to hundreds of thousands of Texans each year. This year's theme is for the Home Care and Hospice Month is the care you need in the home you love. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Hidalgo County Commissioner's Court hereby proclaims November 2016 as Home Care and Hospice Month and encourages the support and participation of all citizens in learning more about the home care and hospice philosophy of care for the elderly, disabled, and terminally ill. Approve this 15th day of November 2016.
Move for approval.
Second. Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Good morning. Good morning. My name is Nancy Perez. I'm a registered nurse, and I'm the administrator and the nurse director at Outreach Health Services for the Edinburgh and Corpus office. Outreach Health Services is a Texas-based home health care company that has been in existence since 1975. We provide a broad range of health-related services to clients with varying needs. With more than 7,000 employees in communities throughout Texas, including highly trained nurses, aides, nutritionists, dietitians, therapists, social workers, and other professionals, we have always strived to provide the highest quality of care to our valued customers and clients. Outreach Health Services helps the elderly and disabled preserve their dignity and maintain their independence while receiving care in a home setting. On behalf of Outreach Health Services and the many home health agencies throughout the county and the state of Texas, I would like to take this opportunity to thank our county judge, Mr. Garcia, and his elected officials for recognizing November as Home Care and Hospice Month. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Did you vote on it?
Did you
yes.
vote on
it? Okay. Yes.
Item 5C.
Good morning, Judge Commissioners. Michael Leo, County Judge's Office. The 5C is discussion and approval of the resolution establishing the Hidalgo County PACE program as permitted by the Property Assessed Clean Energy Act, Texas Local Government Code, Chapter 399. As you may recall, Hidalgo County previously adopted a resolution of intent to establish a PACE program in Hidalgo County. The program will allow business community to obtain financing from approved lenders to make efficiency improvements such as water conservation, energy efficiency, and renewable retrofits. The county is looking to partner with the COG to administer this program on our behalf. You know, we've been working on this project for over a year now. It's been a long time coming. We've been monitoring the progress in other counties as well because the program is still relatively young here in Texas, but we're eager to move forward. We've worked with the chiefs of each precinct, with Mr. Cantu. We've worked with Valdez, Sergio at the budget, Paul Villarreal, and his staff at the tax office. And now we've been really hands-on involved with the civil division of the DA's office, Victor, Josie, and Aaron Thorne as well, who's helped us with the documents that we have before us today. So now we are working with purchasing. There's still some protocols to define as it relates to potential delinquencies if they were ever to occur. We anticipate these will be rare if they do happen, and if they do occur, it will be, you know, a year, 2 years down the line. We're working with Mari and her staff regarding potential procurement, and we've also had discussions with our delinquent tax attorneys. Since statute for this program dictates that these delinquencies are actually handled in the same manner as delinquent ad valorem taxes, so there's a connection there. We're going to continue to refine the process moving forward, but we didn't want to hold up the PACE program anymore, the PACE program itself. We've been advised that there's already businesses lining up, eager and ready, to take advantage of the PACE program in Hidalgo County. For the record, we have representatives today from the Rio Grande Valley Development Council. We have Ron Garza, who's here. We have Terry Salinas, the executive, the Economic Development Director, is right here. Charlene Heidinger from the PACE Authority is here. We've also had a lot of support from the local EDCs. Today we have Janie Cavazos from the McAllen EDC. And with the court's permission, we'd just like to allow them to say a few words.
Thank you so much. Good morning. My name is Janie Cavazos. I'm with McAllen Economic Development Corporation. I'm the Vice President for U.S. Business Recruitment and Business Retention Expansion. We appreciate you supporting this program because we understand that a lot of these companies that exist here in McAllen that manufacture and bring a lot of jobs, create jobs, are looking at this program very seriously. They're interested, and of course, we appreciate your support in this program. Thank you so much.
Good morning, Judge. Good morning, Commissioners. I just want to appreciate, you know, say that we appreciate the support for this program. It's really exciting for a program like this around clean energy. We think it's really dynamic, could bring a lot of new job opportunities and growth to our area. Thank you.
So if there's any other questions, we're with the court's consideration.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Okay. We have one other item related to this. It's the approval of the interlocal agreement between Hidalgo County and the Lower Rio Grande Valley Development Council to assist in implementation of the PACE program by providing administrative support. Again, this was put together and approved by our legal, by Aaron and Lynn Victor at the Josie's office. So,
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Okay. And with the court's permission, we'd like to take a photo, please.
All right.
Thank you.
Can I go on with item 5D?
Yes, sir.
Approval of order and interlocal agreement by and among the City of FAR, Hidalgo County, and Tax Increment Reinvestment Zone Number 2, City of FAR, Texas, allowing for Hidalgo County to participate in the Tax Increment Reinvestment Zone Number 2. Again, this is another one that's been a long time coming. We've been working on this for a while. We've had extensive meetings with the city, with the precinct, with precinct 2, with budget, with the legals, with the judge, with the mayor. I think the City of FAR has been really amenable and receptive to some of the recommendations that we've made. So we finally have a working document that both sides are comfortable with. Mr. Juan Guerra from the City of FAR is here on behalf of Mayor Hernandez. I think the city already approved it on their end as well. The auditor did have some comments. They had a recommendation, actually, and they just wanted to put it on the record. That
Mr. Guerra, do you want to come forward? In case any commissioner may have a question.
The auditor's recommendation was to just to maybe implement some kind of language that would allow the county to withhold payments until commencement of the actual project. Now, we've spoken with legal about this. We don't have right now the statutory authority that had to kind of do that. We're kind of mandated by statute that we're going to participate to put the funds in the TERS account, in the TIF account, I should say. But we did say we'd be willing to, you know, explore that further for future ones. But in this particular one, it's not. This is our standard interlocal agreement that we do with all TERS. So,
now, do we approve it as is, or is it contingent on all the language that we've talked about?
Yeah, I think we're good on both sides. Yes, so we can approve it as is.
Okay.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you. Good morning, Judge and County Commissioners. Yes, my name is Juan Guerra. I'm the city manager for the City of FAR. First and foremost, on behalf of Mayor Dr. Ambrosio Hernandez and the City Commission, thank you very much for supporting this item. Judge, thank you for your leadership. I know we had some issues, and you stepped in and you helped us out. Thank you very much. But County Commissioners, thank you all very much for your support.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
And then we have one other item related, item 2. As we do with all interlocals when we participate in TERSs, appointment of one board member to represent the County of Hidalgo on the Tax Increment Reinvestment Zone Number 2, City of FAR, Texas Board of Directors.
Who are you recommending, or who under our policy would be in line?
Our policy has a TERS committee that's involved in the process. It's all initiated at our office, and then we work in conjunction with the precinct and the budget office as a team. In the last, you know, 5 or 6 years or so, we had Valdez on a few, Bobby's on a few. On TERS Board 1 for the City of FAR, we have Bobby. Now, I don't know if TERS Board 2 meetings are going to be held in conjunction or at the same time as the TERS Board 1, but it's open for the court's discretion.
Him? Michael.
Mike, do you want to serve?
I'd be willing to serve, yes.
Okay. You're it.
Your answer.
a motion to
move for approval.
Designate Mr. Mike Leo as our representative on that board. Is there a second?
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Okay. And for those meetings, we're going to continue to work with the precinct as well. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. All right. Item number 7, our DA's office.
Good morning, Judge, Commissioners. Item 7A, Rosalinda Cantu presenting for the District Attorney's Office. Item 7A, Hidalgo County DA's Office, Domestic Violence Specialty Prosecutor Grant, approval to submit a Domestic Violence Specialty Prosecutor Grant budget adjustment to the Office of the Governor.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
7B, the DA U.S. Department of Justice funds, appropriation of funds in the amount of $15,000 to fund the purchase of equipment for law enforcement personnel.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
7C, Hidalgo County DA's Office Victim Assistance Program Grant. Approval to submit a Victim Assistance Program Grant budget adjustment to the Office of the Governor.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
7D, Border Prosecution Unit Grant. Approval to submit a Border Prosecution Unit Grant budget adjustment to the Office of the Governor.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Item 8, our constables.
Good morning, Judge Commissioners. Martin Blanco, Constable's Office, Precinct Number 1.
Morning,
I have
sir.
Item 8A, Constable Precinct 1, with the Texas Tropical Behavior and Health Discussion, Number 1. Discussion, consideration, and approval to enter into an interlocal agreement between Adel County and Tropical Texas Behavioral Health.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
A2, authorization to pay overtime reimbursable under the interlocal agreement terms and conditions.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Number 3, authorization for county judge as authorized official to sign the interlocal agreement award and related documents.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Number 4, approval of certification of revenues by the county auditor.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Number 5, approval of the following personal action effective December 1st, 2016 to create under the Department Program 291-013, slot number 0001, there will be Deputy Constable Step 1 with a proposed budget salary of $44,577.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Number 6, approval of appropriation of funds.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Number 7, approval to revise the salary schedule in accordance with the Commissioner's Court action.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries. For the record, the salary is $44,577.
Yes, sir. Correct. Judge, Commissioners, thank you. You have a good day.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. All right, Constable Precinct 3.
Good morning, Commissioner, Judge. Chief Deputy Gonzalez with Adel County Constable Precinct 3. Today we have discussion, consideration, approval to appoint Eric Flores, Joam Moreno as Deputy Constables by Constable Larry Gallardo, Constable Precinct 3, accordance with Texas Local Government Code, Section 86011.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Second item is a discussion, consideration, approval to appoint Kimberly Jean Echeverria as a reserve deputy constable by Constable Larry Gallardo, Jr., Constable Precinct 3, in accordance with Texas Local Government Code, Section 86.12.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Item 9, our Sheriff's Office.
Good morning, Judge, Commissioners. Captain Alcantu, on behalf of our Hidalgo County Sheriff, Mr. Eddie Guerra. Item 9A, Sheriff's Office, FBI 284. Number 1, approval to accept overtime funding agreement from the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, in the total amount of $17,753.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Number 2, authorization to pay overtime reimbursable under grant terms and conditions.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye. Can we do all of them at the same time in those categories, Steve?
You can probably do 3 and 4 together.
All right.
Okay. Number 3, approval of certification of revenues as certified by the county auditors for the fiscal year 2017 FBI overtime agreement. And number 4, approval of appropriation of funds in the amount of $17,753.
For approval on 3 and 4.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And, Judge, I believe on the next ones you can also do B, C together. I mean, all, everything under B and everything under C together.
All right. Go ahead, sir.
So do all of them together or just item B?
Yes.
Item B.
Item B.
B1 through 4.
Okay. B1, approval to accept overtime funding from U.S. Department of Homeland Security, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE, fiscal year 2017, in the amount of $15,000. B2, authorization to pay overtime reimbursable under the grant terms and conditions. 3, approval of certification revenues as certified by the county auditor for ICE overtime funding. And 4, approval of appropriation of funds in the amount of $15,000.
Move for approval on B1 to 4.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Item C, 1, authorization approval memorandum of understanding between Behavioral Health Solutions of South Texas and Hidalgo County Sheriff's Office to provide female inmates with pregnant postpartum intervention, PPI, program services. 2, authorization for county sheriff to sign the document. 3, authorization approval memorandum of understanding between Behavioral Health Solutions of South Texas and the Hidalgo County Sheriff's Office to provide male inmates with parenting awareness and drug risk education, padre program services. And 4, authorization for county sheriff to sign said document.
Move for approval on sheet 1 to 4.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you, Judge.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Judge, Commissioners, I need to make a correction to an item.
What item, ma'am?
It's item 7B.
B as in boy?
Yes.
All right.
The correct amount should be $18,000 and not
$15,000. $18,000. Okay.
All right.
Got it.
We didn't actually
Yeah, let's take action.
On
7B, instead of $15,000, be $18,000. Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank
aye.
You.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 10, Human Resources.
Sure, go ahead. Morning, Judge Commissioners. Robert Sabiotto presenting for Human Resources. Item 10A for the Sheriff's Office, discussion, consideration, approval of the following personnel actions effective next full pay period. This item is to provide clothing allowance for slots number 0084 and 0086 in the amount of $500 as listed on item 1.
Move for approval.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And 2 is approval to revise the salary schedule in accordance with your action.
Move for approval.
Second. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Item B is for the domestic violence court grant in the criminal DA's office. 1, we're requesting a waiver of the budget amendment policy for personnel related amendments.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And 2 is discussion, consideration, action to approval to authorize supplemental pay allowance to the following employee effective the next full pay period. That would be employee number 0010 and assistant district attorney 3 in the amount of $11,720.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
3 is approval to revise the salary schedule in accordance with the Commissioner's Court action.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item C, Judge Commissioners, is an item that was approved last week, but there was a technical glitch, and so we're doing it again. It's simply a technicality, so it reads approval to rescind action on item 9A, agenda item 57070 from last Commissioner's Court.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
This is requesting a waiver, and item 2 is requesting a waiver of the budget amendment policy for personnel related actions.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And item 3 is discussion, consideration, approval of the following personnel action. And this is simply to provide longevity pay for this employee from the general fund because the grant does not allow it. And that would be to remove longevity from slot number 7925 and the grant in the amount of 480 and to approve to create slot 7104 and 7124 to add the longevity for that employee.
So cool.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And 4 is approval to revise the salary schedule in accordance with the Commissioner's Court action.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item D, for facilities management, discussion, consideration, approval of the following to change a position title as follows. This is simply a position title. The employee is functioning as a custodian. There's no change in salary, no change in assignment, simply changing the title from air conditioned technician helper to custodian 2, same salary.
For approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item E for Precinct 4, Road Maintenance, discussion, consideration, approval of the following personnel actions effective next full pay period. The precinct is requesting to delete two positions, slot number 0034, Equipment Operator 1 at $26,341, slot 0078, Administrative Assistant 4 at $36,312, and create slot 0084, GIS Operator 3 at a salary of $52,937.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And item 2 is approval to revise the salary schedule in accordance with the Commissioner's Court action.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
That's all I have. Thank you, Judge Commissioners.
Thank you.
Good morning, Judge Commissioners. Eddie Olivares, Hidalgo County Health and Human Services. Item 12A, Health Care Funding District. Sir, item A1, there is no action unless there's discussion or questions. Item 11B, Indigent Health Care Program, discussion and action, Indigent Health Care, without limited Indigent Health Care Program, or 1115 waiver. I don't have any items unless you have any specific questions.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Item 12, our IT department.
Good morning, Judge Commissioners. Quick item. It's for Commissioner Precinct 2, authorization and approval to purchase equipment with data service through the county's membership in the Verizon Wireless contract that we have through DIR. It's listed on the grid. It's 5 iPads with mobile broadband. This is what they're using for their ticketing and their incident management software so they can access the tickets and close them in the field. So,
move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
12B, it's a name change on an already approved device. There's no cost involved.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you, sir. Item 13, Urban County.
Jenna, good morning. Happy belated birthday.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Jenna had a birthday yesterday.
Oh, wow. Happy birthday.
But I don't look older, right? Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Our first item on the agenda is 13A. Requesting approval to reject the sole bid received for the City of Edcouch Park Improvement Project, which is supposed to be Bell Park, and we only received one bid, so we're hoping to re-advertise and get a better.
Move for approval.
Thank second. You.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 13B is requesting approval of an order granting an exemption from competitive bidding requirements under Texas Local Government Code Chapter 262, Section 0.024A7, an item that can be obtained from only one source.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item B2 is approval of a self-source declaration with authority to enter into contribution in aid of construction agreement with AEP Texas Central Company in the amount of $17,806.92 for Zone 5-Final, the installation of primary poles and street lights within the City of Sullivan City.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item C is subject to House Bill 1295 compliance, requesting consideration and action to award and enter into a construction contract with 2GS LLC, doing business as Earthworks Enterprise, in the amount of $226,127 for a City of San Juan Street improvement project.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item D is requesting approval to reject the sole bid received for the City of Palmview. It's a Parks and Recreational Facility Improvement line item for Showers Road Project. Again, we had one bid, and we'd like to re-advertise.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item E is discussion and approval to declare the assets listed in Exhibit A as surplus for disposition.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Good morning, Judge. Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Yvonne Ramon, Elections Office.
First item is discussion and interaction, including but not limited to election updates. So first of all, I would just like to big thank you to my entire election staff for an election well run. My supervisors in VR, Belinda Sagredo and Brenda Renteria in Elections Operations Division, Melissa Alvarez, and of course my IT supervisor, Michael Sosa. The various departments that helped us out, for example, the district attorney's office, the four constables, especially Constable Gaitan, facilities management, also always Mr. Daniel Flores, IT County, Mr. Renan Ramirez, helping us out with phone situations and those types of things. And of course, now comes our treasurer's office, Ms. Norma Garcia, with the incredible amount of pay that needs to go out. So thank you to our judges, our poll location judges, our alternate judges, and our clerks at every poll location, hardworking and dedicated. Enough thank yous are never enough to say and to thank them for the job well done.
You ought to pat yourself on the back also.
Great job.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge.
But we had a record turnout. How many people
we did. We did. In fact, I'm coming back next week because I wanted to give you an update. We've got over 1,312 write-ins that have to be reviewed today by ballot board. They're already at my office. We've got 652 provisionals, 208 limited ballot, and 14 overseas that they will be reviewing today. So that's over 2,190 ballots. So I will come back next Tuesday for the canvassing so that we can really see what that record turnout was. Definitely like no other.
I can't thank you for what you did. I know you stepped into having to have to not just conduct all these different elections throughout our county, but have to testify in court twice or two different occasions, and you did a commendable job.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate that very much. Item number two is approval of the 2016 General Election Service Contract between Hidalgo County Elections Department and the FAR San Juan Alamo Independent School District that was held on November 8, 2016.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Number three, approval of the 2016 General Election Service Contract between Hidalgo County Elections Department and the City of Benitas that was held on November 8, 2016.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
So I will be sending all of you the results after today so that you may review, and then canvassing will take place next Tuesday, the 22nd.
Very good.
Thank you.
Item 15, our Head Start program.
Good morning.
Letter A.
We have the discussion and approval to appoint a community member representative for each member of the Commissioner's Court to serve on the Head Start Program Policy Council for 1 year, according to 45 CFR Chapter 13, 1304.50B1B7, beginning in October. Pending appointments, we have Commissioner A.C. Cuev and Commissioner Joseph Palacios.
Cristina Longoria, come down.
Cristina?
Cristina Longoria.
We'll get with your office for contact.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to hold off still. I'll let you know. I'll let you know when to bring the item back on instead of coming every week.
I'll do it that way, yes. Yeah. And for the time being, Doctor...
He's still on the holdover
position anyway. He'll stay on,
okay.
Yes.
And I'm not in violation of the time. Okay, perfect.
We're okay.
Yeah, yes. I still haven't sat with him, that's why. So
okay.
I need to sit down with him.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So that requires approval.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
The next items are items that are coming to you before they go to Policy Council in a matter of... trying to get the partnership with McAllen ISD going and starting this month rather than waiting for 2 weeks in December to not occur this year. So the first part has to do with a calendar for program year 2016-2017 with the partnering school district, McAllen ISD, and we provide a calendar that matches the district calendar, and we work with our staff to be able to work that one out since they're going to be sending teachers from the district to every classroom that we have in the district, in our centers.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
We really have a kind of a standard MOU for school readiness, and so we're presenting this for discussion and consideration and approval to enter into MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, between Hidalgo County Head Start Program and McAllen Independent School District, and they've already approved it through their board. So administration recommends your consideration.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And then the next one has to do with trying to dispose of items. We have approval to declare obsolete the attached list of items and transfer items to the county's approval auctioneer vendor for proper disposition. And there's a list provided for you.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion aye. Carries.
Yes. Thank you so very much.
Thank
Have
you.
Have a great day.
Precinct 2, approval of certification of revenue as certified by the county auditor for revenue received from the city of San Juan for interlocal agreement approved by Commissioner's Court on 10-14 of 14.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. 16-8-2, approval of 2016 appropriation of funds into Precinct 2 road maintenance in the amount of $100,000.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Precinct 3, Commissioner Flores' office, Mingo.
Well, good morning, guys.
What's that, Mingo?
I want to say that I miss you for 2 weeks. I'm back.
You're back. Welcome back.
Yes. On Precinct 2, Precinct 3, number 17A, authorization to submit economically disadvantaged county EDC program application affidavit for the FM 681 project with authority for county judge to sign all required documentation.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank sir. You. Precinct 4, Commissioner Palacios.
Yeah, 18A is a request approval of the process of following invoices as a claim with the authority of the county treasurer to issue payment after review, audit, and processing procedures are completed by county auditor. It's the Cleveland Asphalt Products Incorporated, invoice number 18321 for $6,073.06.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Budget and management.
Good morning, Commissioners. Cecilio Cruz, Department of Budget Management. Item 19A is requesting approval to submit the fiscal year 2017 Hidalgo County Formula Grant Program application and requesting approval and signature for the 2017 Hidalgo County Resolution for the Indigent Defense Grant Program.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 19B is authority for the county judge to sign the TxDOT form right-of-way 810 tabulation of values for all parcels associated with the Precinct 1 Mile 6 West Road project, CSJ 09210268, until the completion of these projects.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 19C is approval of medical coverage for the temporary employees as listed on the agenda. As per the Affordable Care Act, IRS code section 4980H. We're having to provide insurance because they've exceeded the threshold, the number of hours during the year, so we need to provide insurance for these two temporary employees.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 19D1 is approval of 2016 appropriation of funds in the amount of $9,873.15.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 19D2 is approval of 2016 appropriation of funds to CO's 2014 Precinct 4 83rd Street project in the amount of $127,893.50.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you, Sergio.
Thank you, Dirk.
Hi, Ms. Marty.
Item 20, under Purchasing Department, Martha Salazar, A1. This is presentation of the sole response received from Southmost Realty Appraisals and Court Expert for expansion of the current appraisal pool providers for addition to the existing pool and with the term eligibility to coincide with the expiration of the current pool of March 2017. This will put us back to five. And then I have an alternative for you on the next one. So we need action on this one first.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
B is authority to advertise an additional time to encourage more participation for the expansion of the pool with all the parameters to remain the same. It would expire next March if we do get any participants this time.
Move for approval.
Okay.
Second. All in favor say aye. 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 Motion carries.
Item 2 is requesting approval to declare the items listed in Exhibit A as surplus for the upcoming auction, and if not sold on December the 7th, then retry to sell on December 10th in accordance with Texas Local Government Code 263-152, and if in event no bids are received on either auction date.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Pursuant to Texas Local Government Code 263-151L and or 263-152A3, Commissioner's Court proceed to order any of the property to be destroyed or otherwise disposed of as worthless inasmuch as the sale of the items that Commissioner's Court undertook under the previous item resulted in no bids that were received.
Move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Requesting authority to publish advertisement for the auction of the surplus equipment and vehicles scheduled for December 7th and if need be December 10th, including but not limited to seized, abandoned, and unclaimed property for additional and or necessary auctions.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item B1 for Precinct 1. This is requesting authority to advertise, including the authority to re-advertise the project in the event no bids are received and the project is still required, with approval of the request for bid plans and specs developed by the project engineers, and then using the newly accepted packet that was approved by Commissioner's Court recently for A, RFB 398, that's mile 11 north, mile 13 and a half north, Yvette Circle, Lefebvre Engineering as the project engineer.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item B is RFB number 399. That's Indian Hills with Ted Z as the project engineer.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And item C is RFB 400. That's mile 1.5 west, Jesus Flores, Engelman, Las Cumbres, mile 20 north. International Consulting are the engineers.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 2 is requesting approval to process the following invoices as claims with authority for the county treasurer to issue payment after all the procedures are completed. That's Lefebvre with the two items listed. Although there were POs issued, there was services rendered prior to the PO.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Item 3 is pursuant to Dell County exiting elected official policy requesting approval of the following requisitions and or PO increases for Hidalgo County Precinct 1, and they're the ones listed on the agenda.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Precinct 2, acceptance and approval work authorization 1 with an estimated cost of $112,637.52 as submitted by project engineer B2Z Engineering to provide engineering services for the feasibility study, construction management, and construction inspection for the Palmer Pavilion project.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Acceptance and approval of work authorization 2 with an estimated cost of $12,474 from B2Z Engineer to provide those services to assist with the feasibility study and construction phase services for the Community Resource Center Youth Facility project.
Move for approval.
Second.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carried.
Recommendation by project engineer LNG for Hidalgo County Commissioner's Court to award to the responsible vendor submitting the lowest and best bid while meeting all specifications. There were 7 packets distributed and requested and distributed, and 2 submitted bids. They are recommending Texas Cordia in the amount of $713,333.15 for RFB number 281 Yuma Avenue Extension.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 4 is authority to purchase 1 2017 Freightliner 114SD through Dow County's participation by board contract 425-13 and HGAC HT06-16 from the Houston Freightliner Incorporated with the amount of $271,000 through submitted requisitions as posted and subject to SAM's compliance.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Precinct 4, D1, approval to exercise county sole option to terminate the on-call professional services agreement number 384, 15-384, and work authorization 1 for Brush Lane Road project with those logistics pursuant to Precinct 4's request.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Item 2 is authority to exercise a 60-day grace period extension with Califas Western Wear to the purchase of straw hats. I don't think this belongs to D1. As needed basis under the same rates and terms and conditions expiring on 1/4/17 upon completion of the current procurement, whichever comes first.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 3, pursuant to action taken on 10/25 under agenda item 57026, requesting to amend the contract number 321 with Rigney from 60 calendar days to 45.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
E1 for HIDA, authority to purchase 5 2017 vehicles for Idaho County Task Force, HIDA Task Force, through our membership and participation with buy board contract number 430-13 and HGAC contract number VE11-17 from awarded vendors Cowboy Chevrolet, Dodge, and Caldwell Chevrolet, respectively, through submitted requisitions as posted in the amount of $55,361.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Item F1, Health and Human Services Department, requesting approval of extension purchase upgrade agreements, termination of current security monitoring services with replacement of new security monitoring service with Superior Alarms, awarded to the buy board contract 4331-13, county judge's authority or court member or executive officer to sign all needed documents, and therefore the locations posted on the agenda for a total amount of $5,047 for the equipment upgrade, which includes labor distributed among the 7 sites and the monitoring service for a term of 3 years commencing December 1st, 2016.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Item G1, budget and management, approval and acceptance of the negotiated agreement between Idaho County and TriStar Risk Management, ranked by Commissioner's Court on 9/13/16, including the best and final offer of RFP number 16-193, Quality Claims Administration Services for Workers' Compensation.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Presentation of the scoring grid below for the purposes of ranking by Commissioner's Court is qualified. Of the options and responses received and evaluated in connection with RFP number 16-291, excess workers' compensation insurance by sole respondent, Montalvo Insurance, with 2 companies submitted in order to proceed to the next phase, Safety National Casualty with an average score of 91.3 and Colony Insurance Company with an average score of 85.3. Does the court wish to rank them in the order of the scores?
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
B is requesting authority for purchasing department to commence negotiating a best and final offer rate from Montalvo Insurance on behalf of the 2 companies as they were ranked, commencing with the number 1 ranked.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
3, approval to rescind action on July 19, 2016 for agenda item 55433. In relation to a bid awarded with Asset Works for structure valuation and insurance appraisals.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 1 is for the Sheriff's Department for H1 is pursuant to current agreement between Idaho County and MAO Westwood Pharmacy, DBA Westwood Pharmacy, contract number 16039, requesting approval to amend the Exhibit B to reflect the additional listing of legend and non-legend pharmaceuticals prescribed by physicians and titled Exhibit B1 plus the additional drugs that are listed with the addition to, and then subsequent additions of drugs to be placed on consent agendas after this.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Item two is requesting approval of an additional one-year extension for agreements as set forth below. Hidalgo County Sheriff's Office on an as-needed basis under the same rates, terms, and conditions. A, B, and C being Southern Tire Mart, B, Protect Pest Control, and C, Tropical Texas Behavioral Health, MHMR, respectively.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item C is presentation of the scoring evaluation grid for the purpose of ranking by Commissioner's Court of the responses received in connection with a request for proposals for Hidalgo County Sheriff's Office psychological evaluation for all Hidalgo County law enforcement agencies. The participants were Rollins, York, and Associates at a score of 60.5, MLD Mental Health Services of South Texas, 62.5, Gregorio Pina, Ph.D., at a score of 87. Does the court wish to rank them in the order of their scores?
So move.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Let me just mention for the record, 13 packets were requested and distributed, so we did have a lot of participation. I mean, interest, rather. Yeah. Authority for purchasing to proceed to commence negotiations with the number one ranked participant of Dr. Gregorio Pina, Ph.D.
Approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
And then psychological evaluation services for Hidalgo County. I'm sorry. Item B. Item 4A, approval of an exemption for competitive bidding requirements under Texas Local Government Code Chapter 262.024A4, a professional service.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item B is pursuant to the demonstrated competence under the Professional Procurement Act, Government Code 2254-003, acceptance and approval of negotiated engagement agreements, contracts for the provision of physician services for inmates where the Hidalgo County Sheriff's Office Adult Detention Facility, also known as the jail, with the following physicians, Dr. John Lung, M.D., and Dr. Ivan G. Melendez, M.D.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Item 5, presentation of the scoring and evaluation grid for the purposes of ranking Commissioner's Court, the responses received in connection with RFP, Hidalgo County Sheriff's Telecommunications Internet Services. We have SmartCom at 97.5 and Time Warner at 70. Does the court wish to rank them in the order of their scores?
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
B is for the purchasing department to proceed to commence negotiations with the number one ranked participant of SmartCom to complete a services contract for the Dow County Sheriff's Office Telecommunications and Internet Services.
Move for approval.
Second.
Those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
That is all I have. Thank you.
Butler has nothing besides open forum.
Nothing.
Okay. Do you have the list?
Yeah. You'll keep the time, Monica?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right. We have seven presenters. Presenter number one is Mr. Jim Barnes.
Good morning, Judge and Commissioners. My name is Jim Barnes. I live in Mission, and I'm a member of the Owls and president of the McAllen Tea Party. I understand that people are working on what the language of the next bill to file in the legislature on health care in Hidalgo County is working right now. Why are you using the crutch of the Texas legislature to impose a solution to this problem? Isn't Hidalgo County able to arrive at a solution on its own? Are you afraid of what the taxpayer public will propose on our own? Or should we follow the money? The money spent to get it passed, perhaps. Hidalgo voters have spoken twice. We do not want an additional tax. We already had a program for indigent health care. These bills have added an additional taxing entity that was only indirectly responsive to the taxpayer, paid for a medical school with tax dollars when the University of Texas has one of the largest endowments in the country. During the Petrillo-McAllen debate on the healthcare district, one of the proponents, Ann Cass, who I believe is in the audience, mentioned that she was disappointed that the second attempt did not include a committee of local voters to discuss the issue and arrive at a workable plan. Instead, legislators and members of a PAC arrived at their plan and filed it in Austin. The average citizens had no input. Of course, it failed. This time, why don't you convene a committee of average citizens, not lobbyists or CEOs of hospitals, from both sides of the issue and have them discuss it and make a proposal? A locally implemented plan may pass. This is a Hidalgo County issue. It has nothing to do with the Texas legislature. Thank you.
Next presenter is Marta Sanchez.
Good morning. My name is Marta Sanchez, and I'm in behalf of the membership of Lupe. I wanted to thank Commissioner Cuellar for attending our Junta General general meeting 11 days ago. And also I want to thank you, Commissioner, for all the work that you have done in Precinct 2 and Precinct 1. Also for the list that you gave us of all the projects that you have done, and also for the projects that are still pending that we're going to continue to work with the next commissioner. Also for the big effort that you have done for Indian Hills and finding, and I noticed that it was in the agenda, we noticed that it was in the agenda today. We thank you for that, because we know that it's taking you a lot of effort to find that monies, for that colonia. So thank you for all that effort. And also, I wanted to, next to me is, Olivia said that they're one of our members, but I wanted to switch if the court permits that N goes first and Olivia goes, instead of Ann Cass, if is it okay for the open forum? Is it okay? So the N follows the place of Olivia Zarate, and Olivia Zarate goes in the place of Ann Cass. Is it okay? Yes? Thank you.
All right. The next presenter is Olivia Zarate, but is she going to be here?
It's going to be. I'm asking that Ann goes first.
Oh, okay. Ms. Ann Williams Cass.
Good morning, Judge and Commissioners.
Good morning.
My name is Ann Williams Cass. I'm here today as the chairperson of the Rio Grande Valley Equal Voice Health Working Group. In light of the events of last week, I'd like to share thoughts on two issues. First, the current distribution of county indigent care monies, and second, where we can go from here. I was saddened to learn of the continued lack of transparency from the Hidalgo County Clinical Services, Inc., the nonprofit comprised of hospitals in Hidalgo County to administer the Indigent Healthcare Program. I stood before this court years ago and cautioned you about handing over county tax money to them, because after you give them the money, you have little or no control over how they spend it. We have tried unsuccessfully for years to find out when and where they meet, and we're told they meet behind closed doors, and they are not subject to the Open Meeting Act. They have no community advisory committee. They made a decision to eliminate ancillary services provided under Section 65 of the Health and Safety Code. These services included dental, number one reason why children miss school, vision, and services performed by mid-level health professionals. We were told those services were eliminated to save money, and yet I understand this year there was money left over. It's sad that the county gave the same amount last year, $5.5 million to indigent care, as they did in 2012. And my next statement may sound a little mean, but I couldn't help thinking this morning when I heard that the city of Brownsville gave more than that for their animal shelter. The number of clients served has gone from 7,400 in 2012 to 5,200 in 2016. The County Clinical Services, Inc. advertised this summer for more clients. What are they doing with their money? Why can't they add back the ancillary services that they removed or increase the eligibility from 21% of poverty to 25 to 30%? It doesn't seem like they're fulfilling the obligation that the county has to provide health care for indigents. Yes, the health district did fail, and it failed big time. And we did support it because we wanted 20% of the money to go to the safety net clinics, and we wanted an advisory board. I have to say that I didn't hear one opponent indicate or state that they didn't want to help poor people with their health care. Most people that I talked to said that they felt the hospitals were crying poor with a loaf of bread under each arm. Commissioner Cantu, you spoke of needing a plan. Well, I would like to challenge you to put together a diverse working group to come up with a plan to cover Inogen Healthcare, which would include assistance to the safety net clinics. Our Equal Voice Health Working Group would be more than happy to assist you, and I personally would like to see my own commissioner, Mr. Palacios, on that working group. I would hope this group would fix the problems that we have right now with the Hidalgo County Clinical Services and find a way to make health care more available for more people. We have to come up with something. I'm tired of offering only a shoulder to cry on for families that come into my office seeking resources for cancer treatment, dialysis, minor surgery. I'm tired of seeing people trying to raise money for health treatments through barbecues. And I'm tired of seeing... Okay, I'm tired of seeing people die because they don't have insurance. It's time we take seriously the challenge of our Constitution. It will be difficult. It may be impossible, but I recall my dad quoting a slogan from the Army Corps of Engineers during World War II. The difficult we can do, the impossible will take a little longer. Let's get started. People's lives are at stake.
Thank you, ma'am. Next presenter is Olivia Zarate.
Muy buenos días. Mi nombre es Olivia Zárate y vengo de la colonia Eduardo Socho. Soy miembro de la organización de Lupe y de la red de Voces Unidas. Como promotora de salud en mi comunidad, yo he visto la necesidad que existe por falta de cuidado médico accesible. Mucha gente se enferma y no tiene suficientes recursos y se quedan sin consultar con ningún médico. Les pedimos de la manera más atenta que estén al tanto del cuidado de salud de nuestro condado de Hidalgo. Todos nosotros apoyamos la propuesta de Voces Unidas para empezar a buscar soluciones a esta necesidad. Muchas gracias.
Good morning. Now I'm going to translate. Hi, my name is Olivia Zarate. I come from the colonia Eduardo Socho. I am a member of Lupe and of the Equal Voice Network. As a promoter of health in my community, I have seen the need that exists due to the lack of accessible medical care. Many people get sick and there are little resources. People are left in limbo without being able to consult a doctor. We ask that you hold a health summit about this issue. We want a healthy Hidalgo County. We support what Equal Voices is asking. Thank you.
Thank you. Next presenter is Virginia Townsend.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You guys think you got rid of me or something? I haven't been here for a while. I am encouraged by everything I've heard because I did want to talk about Inogen Health. I want it back where we're going to take care of it as Hidalgo County. I don't want it through the legislature, and I certainly don't want it going to the taxpayers. It's not going to pass, ever. People cannot take any more taxes. I hope our representatives, whether it's Senator Chuy Hinojosa or Bobby Guerra, I hope they've learned it, because I don't want to see us have to go through this again. It's a lot of ill will and bad feelings. But if everybody is ready to work together, I think we can do it as a county. And I thank you very much, you guys. You're still talking to me, I guess, because we have certainly been on opposite sides lately. Thanks.
Next presenter is Fern McLarity.
I have two items today. The first is I want to thank God. I told God that if we won, I would stand on the square, so I'm starting here. I thank God for the win. I thank God for Beto, the mayor of Mission. I thank God for Eddie Cantu. I thank God for the mayor of Weslaco. But most of all, I thank God for the 111,723 voters that voted no, that they could not afford this. I hope y'all are listening because the people are looking. So, and like Virginia said, I think we're supposed to be paying 8 to 10%. Y'all voted to go down. You care so much. Let's get that money back. Today, I also have Democrats and Republicans. The ballot board, the whole board was going to come, but y'all to make it so hard to figure out when you're having open forum. But we have come as a Republican and a Democrat requesting a building for the elections office. This is the saddest thing I have ever seen in my life. When was the last time any of y'all went over to the elections office? Right by Ramon's office. That is the most sickest, dirtiest, unbelievable, cramped for every employee that's there. We are requesting, as a Democrat and a Republican, that you go over to Robert Chevalier. There's a building there that holds junk furniture, junk, anything you want. Get that out of there and build on, add to, and fix up so that the elections has a building that we're able to work. You put Republicans and Democrats together, elbow to elbow, we have a little bit of trouble. So I don't know if you want to say something, but we're asking for y'all to look into this.
Good morning. I'm Kenna Giffen. I'm with the Democratic Party. I'm judge of the ballot board this time. And thank you for allowing us to talk with y'all and present this information. You may have noticed health just froze over. I agree with Fern on something. And it may never happen again, but it's this one. We really need to do something with elections. We processed 8,017 or 19 mail ballots this time. We spent week before last, we spent at the annex. That was a much better situation, much healthier situation for everybody. And I think, you know, if we can just move the vault over there or something, whatever we need to do to give us room to work. Today, we're in the elections office. I invite you all to come over and maybe help us process the rest of the overseas ballots and the write-ins and the provisionals. We've got 600-some provisional ballots to work on. And we're calling all over each other. And we're calling all over the election staff, and nobody can hear anything because everybody else has to talk. And again, the health issues, my understanding is it's really, really bad. And I know several of the election staff are sick, and maybe the building's part of it. But if there's any way possible that we could do something about the elections office, get some sort of improvement there. I understand Fern has agreed that her taxes can go up to help pay for that. I certainly don't mind kicking in a little more because I think it's a lot worse than people realize, and I'm more than happy to show anybody what we're dealing with. Thank you all very much. Really appreciate it. It's always an honor to be here with y'all.
Thank you. And
first time Republican, Democrat standing together.
It must be Trump. Next presenter is Opal Billman.
My name is Opal Billman. When Joe petitioned the court for a divorce, insiders viewed our community property as their business opportunity. A state corporation hedge fund was established, and their investment commodity to buy and sell was our income-producing community property. Furnished the owners with the accounts of all money. Banks are claiming to hold liens on our debt-free land in the amount of $1,060,000 $412.70. How many investigators, prosecutors, judges, lawyers, policemen, politicians, residents of our RV park, and surveyors are invested in this mutual fund company? Every person claiming to own any of the community property belonging to Joe and me should have a title policy ensuring their sale. I want to see every one of them using title policy insurance money to pay off all claims of the individuals, the banks, and the trespassers with their illegal buildings built on our land removed. Between the North Lot 184 and the South Lot 184, the City of Mission has paved a strip of land. Encroachment is a crime, and I want the city to contain its pavement to the boundary line. Anyone believing they have purchased any part of the community property of Joe and me is being misinformed. Joe died April 24, 2003. He owned community property that he did not will. Therefore, Joe's community property became the estate of Joe Billman. Texas law passes the estate of Joe Billman to his three heirs. Our community property is undivided. Therefore, our community property has four owners, which requires our four signatures to be transferred or sold. In regards to a transfer or conveyance without our four signatures, documents convey nothing. Immediately remove the illegal commercial development from our privately owned community property because it's the law.
30 seconds, ma'am.
Because it's the law. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Need a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
So moved.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you, gentlemen. And for the benefit of the public, there will be a meeting next week, next Tuesday.
Same time, same everything. Same time.